had a video of that. You know, it happens a lot more than you think. How many of you, if it hadn't happened to you, you've seen it happen, something like that to somebody on a treadmill? Anybody? Yeah. When I was in college, we saw there was a guy. He was he was on a treadmill, and we were in the weight room in the college, and down in the basement. And he was on the other side of the room on a treadmill, and it got going so fast, and he couldn't turn. You know, there was an emergency off switch button or whatever, and he kept trying to hit. You know, and his legs are hanging, and he's holding on here, and he kept trying to hit the switch, and he never could hit it. So we just stood over in the corner and laughed at him the whole time, I guess. I don't know what we did, but we didn't help him out any. But, you know, sometimes it just, and boy, when that happens, it's just so embarrassing, right? Unless you're, on a pogo stick and you try to get, I don't understand that. That was, you know, what do you expect to happen then? But, anyway, sometimes when we walk around in life, in our Christian life, hopefully we don't fall like that, but we do fall from time to time. We fall. We don't necessarily mean to, but because of we make poor choices or whatever, and we struggle with our walk. And remember, when we say the word walk, spiritually speaking or biblically speaking, we're talking about how we walk is talking about how we live for Christ, okay? And yes, we will stumble. Yes, we will fall. Yes, sometimes we will look kind of silly when we make mistakes or fall, okay? Hopefully our pants won't come down when we fall, but you know what I mean. So, like I did on the video. But sometimes we just stumble and fall. What do we do then? Do we just instantly know how to walk as a Christ follower? No, not really. I mean, not most of the time. A lot of times it takes some time to learn how to walk. Have you ever seen, how many of you have little brothers and sisters? Okay, have you seen them learn how to walk? Do you remember learning how to walk? No, you don't remember, but you've seen your siblings, brothers and sisters, learn how to walk, right? Sometimes it's kind of funny, right, when they're trying to walk and they finally are able to strong enough to stand up and then they start taking a step or two and then they fall, right? You don't instantly just know how to walk, usually. And some of that is in the case within our Christian walk, too. Sometimes we have to learn some things. We have to grow a little bit in our faith before we can really walk in our faith. And sometimes those growing processes or things that we learn, they're not real easy. Sometimes they're painful. Sometimes we fall and we learn that way, by painful. And then we have to learn how to walk again. When Stephen was about 16 months, not 16 years old, he was 16 months, he just learned how to walk pretty good, and he broke his leg, broke the femur, snapped it in two. And it was Leroy's fault, but anyways, it wasn't anybody's fault. He just slipped in the bathtub, and his leg snapped, and it was just a clean break. So we didn't know it. We were in Cincinnati, you know, we didn't know, because he couldn't talk, you know, he was just screaming, you know, he couldn't tell us anything. So we go home to we're at my brother's house, we go to my mom's house, and he falls asleep. So we're like, okay, he just wasn't feeling good or whatever. He wakes up a couple hours later, 3 a.m, something like that, and he's screaming. So I said, we take him to the hospital. So we go to the hospital, they find out, long story short, he has a broken femur. They put him in a body cast. Okay, from armpits all the way down, and he's like this, you know, with a diaper on the inside of the cast and on the outside. He's totally embarrassed me telling this now, and thankfully he's not here. But that's where he was for 6 weeks. 6 weeks. Anybody watch Barney when you were a kid? Did you watch Barney? Was that still around when you were young? When you were younger, Barney. I hate Barney. Okay, because. For 6 weeks, that's all that Stephen would watch was Barney. We had VHS. You don't know what that is, but we had VHS tapes then, and we had five or six Barney tapes, and that was it. And over all day long, all he could do was lay there. So, long story short, 6 weeks later, he gets the cast off. He doesn't know how to walk. He has to learn how to walk again. His leg is still, and his mind is still broken, and he keeps it stiff. So he had to relearn how to walk. Sometimes in our Christian walk, our Christian life, we have to do the same thing. because we've made some poor choices or whatever has happened. We have made something in our walk, as we've stumbled in our walk or whatever, and we have to relearn how to walk. So that's something that we're going to look at tonight in chapter 5 of Galatians. And remember, Galatians, we've talked about these are things that Paul is writing to the church in the city of Galatia. And these are things that he's saying, you need to know these things. Remember, Paul is not there at this time. Paul was there. He helped plant this church. He's gone now. And he's writing this letter to the church. It's not really a book. It's a letter. He's writing this letter, 6 chapters, to this church, just reminding them of some things, because he's hearing some things that aren't so great, okay? He's hearing some things about some false teaching creeping into the church and being taught into the church. So he's warning them about that. And so in chapter 5, we'll look, just as we've gone through this, the verse that we've kind of built this all around is in chapter 6, verse 9, where it says, Paul writes, "And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up." Sometimes the Christian life, the Christian walk, we just get weary, right? Because we feel like we're the only one doing it. We feel like we're the only ones, whatever. It feels like everybody's against us, right? Maybe it doesn't feel that way right now, but trust me, one day it will. One day maybe you'll be in college, you'll be working somewhere, and you'll feel like nobody else is. I mean, it's like I'm the only one trying to do the right thing. And not because you're perfect, you're just trying to do the right thing, and nobody else is doing that, and you feel like you're fighting an uphill battle. And it may feel that way already for you. I don't know. But it doesn't get easier when we get older, okay? Ask any of the adults in the room. It doesn't get easier. Sometimes it gets tougher. Hopefully, we just get a little better at being able to handle it, or at least to live out our faith, even in difficult situations. Sometimes we don't get better. Sometimes we get a little worse at it. Anyways, so let us not get weary. So he says in chapter 1 that we need to be careful, because remember that he says there's imposters are going to be present. These fake prophets are going to be teaching a false message, and they're there, they're going to be present. He says that some will believe their message and leave the church, or leave the faith, and that's happening today, right? Lots of people are kind of just turning against the church, or turning, not just against the church, but turning against Scripture altogether and just leaving the faith. And then he said some will be tempted to even just seek their own praise. And how many of us, if we could really were honest, we would say, I like for people to, notice me from time to time. And there's nothing really all that wrong with that, except for if that's what is our goal in life, then that's where it becomes the issue. Chapter 2, we looked at justification and what that really means. It means that we've been vindicated. We've been saved. That was a French term, or isn't it? Is that a French? Or I don't know. Anyways, so it means that we stutter sometimes. Just get over it. So it means that we think that we can do it on our own, but we're not justified by our works or by our good deeds. We're justified by placing our faith in Christ. And so we talked about justification. It's not based on who you are or where you've been or your family. It's not based on your effort. And it's only possible through a relationship with Christ. Justification, even though we don't use that word much anymore, it really just means that we have been vindicated. We are free of the guilt and shame that really we're deserving of. We're free of that because of what Christ did. Chapter 3, we talked about Bewitched, and we showed you the clip to the old TV show that was on when I was a child. I know none of you were alive then, but just because I'm older than you a little bit. But we talked about that because Paul uses that word bewitched, and it means that you've been enchanted or you've been fooled in some way. And remember, he starts off chapter 3 calling them foolish Galatians. He says, "Oh, foolish Galatians, you foolish Galatians." I mean, how you start off a letter and you talk, Hey, you foolish person. That's how Paul starts chapter 3. So he says, you've been fooled. And so, but by faith, you can finish the journey. By faith, we inherit this, we obtain an inheritance that only Christ gives. And by faith, we have this promise that he will never leave us nor forsake us. We know that through, we read that through chapter 3. Chapter 4, we talked about we still need to proceed with caution. Everything doesn't always go as planned, does it? Has everything in your life, if you're 12 or 20, has everything in your life gone as planned, as what you have planned? And it hasn't, has it? And guess what? It will continue to not go as planned. I'm not the prophet of doom. I'm not trying to paint a bad picture for you. I'm just saying it doesn't go as planned, does it, Miss Karina? It does not always go as planned. And so we just got to deal with it sometimes, right? We just have to go with whatever God's plan is. It may not be our plan, but it's God's plan. And even though we may not see it at the moment, it is what God's will is for our lives. If we are following him, he says sometimes, but we just proceed with caution because there's dangers everywhere. First Peter tells us that the enemy is always on the prowl looking for someone to devour. The enemy, Satan, never gives up. He never stops. So we cannot lower our guard, because if we lower our guard, sometimes we looked in chapter 4 that we might be detained or retained by sin. We'll be trapped into sin. Okay, we may not want to. That's not our goal. But if we're not careful, we get trapped in some sinful lifestyle without realizing it. Then we said that we can be deceived. The Bible talks about the enemy as being the great deceiver and how he deceives us, because he makes things look good on the outside. And remember, Jesus says that he comes in sheep's clothing, but inside is ravenous wolves. So on the outside, he looks harmless, but on the inside, it's very harmful. And we have to be careful of that. We need to know that. What is the difference, and how can we tell the difference there? We can't tell the difference if we're not in step or in tune with God and his word. And then he says, we can't lose, proceed with caution, and don't lose your desire that you have to follow Christ. We'll talk about this a little bit tonight, but when we go to camp, how many of you went to camp this past year or have been to camp with us? Okay. We go, and it doesn't matter if you go to Global Camp or whatever camp. I mean, we go to Global. We've been there for the last 10 years. But anyways, any camp that we go to, I've been to several different camps in 20 years of doing what I do. And we all, there's always this spiritual high, right? Even if you go to children's camp, Center Kid, whatever we go to, there's always this spiritual high you have at camp, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. I think that's one of the great parts of camp. That's what I love about camp. Because you get away from all the distractions, you get away from everything that's happening around you here and back in the real world, you know, back at home. And we go to a place that's kind of desolate where cell phones, I tell everybody, right, bring them. I don't care because they don't work. It doesn't matter. You know, you're not getting any service much up there, so just bring them. But because, and we get away from that, and it's just such a, you know, and you go through withdrawal for a while, and we all do, because I go through withdrawal without my cell phone too. But then we realize we are able to hear clearer from God. And we come back just from camp just so hyped up and pumped up and ready to just, you know, reach our school and win our friends. And there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not making fun of that at all. I'm not making light of that. But how often does that last? That desire. So we have to continue, and it's not like we need to do camp every night. We can't do that. So we have to find a way in our own spiritual lives, in our own lives, to continue to burn that desire that is within us. To burn that desire. Okay? I think they're burning something down back there, but it's okay. So we're continuing to live by faith. So tonight, then last week, was it last week? Jared talked about, he went back into chapter 2, and we took a look at chapter 2 in Ephesians, or not Ephesians, in Galatians. He stayed in Galatians. He didn't go in Ephesians. He went into Galatians. So we looked at not be a double agent, and we looked at a passage out of chapter 2 that went right along with what Paul was telling to the Galatian believers. And tonight we're in chapter 5. So we're going to start off. I'm not going to read the whole chapter to you, but we're going to just kind of skip around different parts of the chapter. So you have to bear with me, okay? It'll all be on the screen unless Heather put the wrong passage up, but she never does that. So she put the right one up, I'm sure. So chapter 5, again, I'm going to skip around, so just bear with me, okay? Chapter 5, verse 1 says this, but freedom for Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. We don't. If we have a relationship with Christ, we're not a slave to sin anymore. We don't have to fall to that slavery of sin anymore. We can stand firm in our faith and not give in. And then verses 7 and 8, I'm jumping around. He says, you were running well. Who hindered you? In other words, what got in your way? Who caused you to stop running so well? Remember, when you hear the word running or walking, he's talking about your spiritual life, your spiritual walk. You were doing a great job. You were moving so well. What happened? Who caused you to stumble? He says, who hindered you? How many of you use that word today, hindered? Nobody, right? We don't use that word anymore, but it means who caused you to stumble, who got in your way, who caused you to trip, okay? Something like that. So you were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion is not from him, Jesus, who calls you. Then he says, I don't know if this will be up there, but I wanted to read this. Verse 9, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. And that is a key verse, and we'll come back to that in just a second. Then skip over with me to verses 16 through 25. I think that's the last part, right? But then he says, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. Does that make sense, right? The desires of the Spirit of God are against the desires of the flesh, the sinful nature, and vice versa. They're both against each other. He says, but if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which means everyone should be able to see them. They're obvious. The works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, adultery. Idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And if we stop there, we'd be like, wow, that's pretty deep. But thankfully, he doesn't stop there. Verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Remember what he said earlier? We're not slaves to sin anymore. We live free in Christ. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh. Remember those things that we just read about, the things of the flesh? If you belong to Christ, those things should be dead. That's what he's saying. We've crucified those things. They no longer exist in our lives and with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Oh, let there be light. Let us live by the Spirit. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. So, the long passage, I get that. Let me just break it down for you, okay, a little bit. So here's what he means, I think. When we are learning to walk or we are keeping in step with the Spirit, we need to understand that we can be restrained easily. What does that mean? He says in verses 7 and 8, you were running so well. What happened? What caused you to stumble? Why did you, what happened? You were doing a great job. Why did you stop? What happened in your walk? Listen, things can be going so well, and just a little distraction can take us in a different direction. Verse 9, which was not, I don't think was on the screen, but I wanted to read it, and it was my fault it wasn't on the screen. It says, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. You know what that means? I mean, just a little bit of something bad can ruin the entire body. You think, well, this one little sin, this one thing that I do, it's not going to be that big of a deal because it's a small thing. according to Scripture and according to Jesus, according to Paul right here, just a little bit is all it takes. And it can destroy the whole batch. Just a little bit can destroy the whole thing. If you're, I do the laundry at my house, and I'm not ashamed to admit that. Most of the time, I don't do it all the time, but I do most of the laundry in my house. And I still have my man card, so it's okay, it's all cool. I like to do the laundry. I don't like how my wife does the laundry, because she just kind of throws everything in together, and I'm kind of OCD, you know. So I separate everything. Everything is separated in my when I do the laundry. So if you put one time we had my wife did the laundry, and she did a load of whites. There were supposed to be whites. And it was a big load of just white, you know, I don't know, just t-shirts, underwear, whatever, all that stuff you don't need to know about, I guess. But there was one, like a red sock in there that she didn't see. Guess what happened? Everything turned pink. So I couldn't wear that shirt anymore because, you know, I ain't that much of a man to wear a pink. I'm not. So the point is this, just a little bit. It doesn't take much, guys. It doesn't take much for that one little thing to just destroy your life. It really doesn't. He says we can be restrained. Being restrained means to prevent a person from doing something or seeing something. He's saying, look, these false teachers, these false messages that were coming, even if you're just believing a little bit of it, it can totally distract you and take you off course. It can take you in a whole different direction, and you don't even realize it. But you just lowered your guard just a little bit. You left it open just a little bit. You left your guard open just a crack, and something creeped in. And it destroyed the whole thing. And it takes you on a path that you never desired to go on. Galatians chapter 3, remember, he says, O foolish Galatians, what has bewitched you? Who's fooled you? What has happened? Who misled you? What or who has fooled you? What has fooled or misled us? I mean, we look at our culture today. Man, we could point at lots of things that has misled us. And I'm not talking about necessarily just bad things. I'm talking about things that mislead even me. I have struggled, most of you know, my whole life, I've struggled really with like my perception of self and you know, am I good enough? Can I do this? Am I capable of doing this? I've always struggled with my self-worth. I'm believing a lie when I do that. Not because I'm great and grand. I'm not saying that. But if God has called you to do something, then listen, He will see it through in you. He will equip you to do whatever it is that He has called you to do. What are you passionate about? Don't let the enemy tell you that you don't need to be doing that you're passionate about. If you find a way to glorify God with whatever that is that you're passionate about, the enemy will try to deceive you. And too often you and I, have believed that. We believe that. We can't believe the lie of the enemy anymore. We have to know that we are easily tripped up. We are easily persuaded to go a different direction. Then he says, secondly, to remove the obstacles. Look at verses 16 through 18. He says, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. And then he lists the desires of the flesh. So what do I mean by removing the obstacles? He says, crucify. He says, but if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. He says, now that these things, and he lists all of them, and he says, these things are to be put to death. Whatever these things of are the flesh are to be just put to death. We're not supposed to follow those anymore. We remove those obstacles. Let's look at when we were learning how to walk again, okay? when you were learning how to walk, I promise you, your parents, grandparents, whomever it was that was watching you when you were learning how to walk, I promise you they didn't put like obstacles on the floor so that you would walk around. Let's see if we'll get through this one. They don't do that, right? What do? We move everything out of the way, right? We get the coffee table out of the way. We don't even have coffee tables. We just move everything out of the way. We get everything out of the middle of the floor, make it wide open. Why? Because it's easier to walk that way. We get rid of all of the other stuff. And then in the middle of the night, parents walk and step on little toys everywhere, right? And then we scream and we fall. But you don't, as a child, you don't. We get everything out of the way so you won't stumble when you walk. We have to remove the obstacles, and we do that in our spiritual life as well. What is it that's causing you to trip up? What is it that's causing you to keep stumbling in your walk with Christ? You know why it's causing you to keep stumbling? Because you haven't removed it. You haven't gotten rid of it. Jesus says that we have to do some pretty extreme things sometimes to get rid of those things in our lives that cause us to keep to stumble, that cause us to keep tripping. We have to do some pretty extreme things to get rid of those things in our lives. And other people, your friends, if they're your real friends, they won't understand it. They won't get it. And that's okay. And they may even make fun of you. What do you mean you're not going to that party? What do you mean you're not watching that show? What do you mean you're not playing that game? What do you mean you don't listen to that song? I don't know what it is. But there's something, there's something that keeps us. Remember, in 2 Corinthians, Paul says, we are a new creation. That the old is gone, the new has come. We're a new creation. That old self that lived by the flesh needs to be gone. In Hebrews chapter 12, the writer says in verse 1, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great cloud of witnesses that are people who have lived by the faith and are living by the faith, he said, let us lay aside every weight and sin that clings so closely or easily entangles us. We get to lay that aside. Get rid of those things that just keeps tripping you up. Whatever it is, get rid of it. You may think, I can't get rid of that. But then you're going to keep tripping. You're going to keep stumbling. We have to get rid of those things. That's what he says. And he says they're evident. The things of the flesh are evident. And he lists them for us. What is it that keeps obstructing your walk with Christ? I don't care, again, if you're 12 or you're 20. You have something. We all do. We all have something, maybe even some things, that keep us, that continue to trip us up. What is it that you need to, that you know you need to get rid of in your life? Can I just say, and I'm not telling you, please don't say that, hey, Pastor Deron said I need to go home and get rid of all my friends. I'm not saying that. But there may be a friendship that needs to die. Not the person die. I'm not saying don't go say that. But there may be a friendship. Listen to me. There may be a friendship that needs to go away. And I'm not saying it's all their fault. Just for whatever reason, they keep causing you to stumble in your faith. I don't know. But there might be that situation for you. That friendship needs to kind of just, if they're going to keep causing you to stumble, that friendship needs to go away. Does that mean we don't love them and pray for them and pray that God would heal, you know, reach them and save? No. We don't just turn away. But listen, if you keep doing something that you know you shouldn't be doing, and it's always there's one common denominator, it's that one person maybe, then guess what? You need to stay away from that one person. It's from my standpoint, I know I'm an old guy, and I'm looking from the outside. From my standpoint, that's an easy, it's not an easy decision, but it's an easy call. I can look at it and know exactly. It's still a hard decision. I get that. Because nobody wants to lose friendships. Nobody wants to say, you know, I really need to take a break. I can't be around you that much anymore because I just make poor decisions. Listen, I know that's got to be hard. I don't know that it's hard on my own because I wasn't strong enough to do that when I was younger. I wasn't. And I made some poor decisions, and it wasn't everybody else's fault. It was my fault. I'm just saying sometimes whatever it is that causes you to stumble, that causes us to stumble, we need to get rid of that thing. And sometimes it's drastic. Sometimes it's drastic. Then the last thing he says, not only are we easily tripped up, and not only do we just need to remove those obstacles, whatever it takes, get rid of those things, he says we need to rely on the support that we have. Verses 23 through 25, just as the flesh, the things of the flesh are evident, the fruit of the Spirit should be evident in our life as well. We have the fruit of the Spirit as a support system for us. Look at it. He says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who have been long to Christ, you've put those things of the flesh to death. We live by the Spirit. You live by the Spirit. You have a support system if you have a relationship with Christ. And that support system is sitting around you, hopefully. Part of it, I mean, part of it is they're sitting around you and they're friends at school. They don't go here. Maybe they go somewhere else. Or maybe they're not here tonight or whatever. But you know who they are. They're your support system and you are their support system. So you support each other. But we also have the support system of the fruit of the Spirit that Christ gives to us. And those should be just as evident as the desires of the flesh in a sinful person. Should be just as evident. How they become evident in our lives? In Colossians chapter 3, verse 1, Paul is writing this letter as well, and he says, if then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. He goes on, and I don't think this will be on your board, but he goes on, verse 2, set your minds, not only seek things above, then he says, verse 2, set your minds on things above, not on things of the earth. Seek things above and set your minds on things above. That's how we find, we rely on the support. That's how we gratify or we find that these fruits of the Spirit, we seek Him. We don't seek things of the earth. We seek Him. We seek things above. We continue to seek Him and read in His Word. Sometimes we have to make ourselves do that, right? I mean, it's not every day that I wake up I'll just be honest. It's not every day I wake up just dying to dig into this, into the Word. I'm just gut honest with you. There's some days I'm kind of lazy. I'm lazy physically, I'm lazy, you know, emotionally, and I'm lazy spiritually sometimes. I just am. But it doesn't mean that I don't need to read God's Word. Sometimes we have to make ourselves do some things that's going to draw us closer to Him. Staying in God's Word will do that. I promise you. His Word promises it will not return void in our lives, which means that if we read God's Word and apply it to our lives, it's going to have an effect on our lives. There's a guarantee it is going to affect our lives. But I don't think that and I say we because I'm a part of that. Let me just say me. Maybe I can't speak for you. I don't think I always truly believe that. even though I just said it to you. Because obviously, if I truly believed every word of that, that God's word will completely affect my life, if I truly believe that, then I would live it out every day. It doesn't mean that I'd always wake up dying, just ready to dig in, but it means I would wake up in the morning and knowing that I have to read this word today because I have to do something, because I know that this is going to affect my life. I don't always have that excitement when I'm reading God's word. So that tells me that I'm not there yet. I've got a ways to go. Just like all of us. God's word will affect your life in a positive way. But not just by holding it. And not just by carrying it around with you. And not just by having it on your nightstand or on your table or on your phone. We have to read it. We have to dig into it. And you think, well, I don't know where to start. Where do I start? Come find it. Well, I'll tell you. I'll give you some hints. I don't know the perfect answer, but I'll just tell you, just start anywhere. Start anywhere. Just read God's word. And if you don't understand it, that's fine. Just keep going. Find somebody, ask somebody, somebody that you trust, and they'll help you understand it, or they'll guide you through it. Just don't give up. Remember what he says, chapter 6, 9 and 10. Let us not grow weary of doing good. Don't give up because you don't understand it. Man, I am so tempted to do that. I like to read, not just the Bible, but I like to read. But if a book doesn't grab my attention within the first chapter or two, man, I can't finish it usually. It's a struggle. Oh, may that not be so of our Christian walk. He says, don't get weary. Even when you don't understand, don't get weary. Don't give up. Don't get weary of doing good. For in the right time, in due season, we will reap. God will reveal to us his plans for us. But it has to be the right time. We have to wait on God and his time. And it may not be the time that we want. We have to wait on him. He says, so then, verse 10, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially those who are outside of the faith. Out of the household of faith. Those that are out there, that don't have a relationship with Christ. Not because they don't come to church, just because they don't have a relationship with Christ. Don't get weary. Don't give up. When you do get weary, don't quit. Don't quit. God will reveal his plan for you and to you. But it may not be on your timetable. It will be on his. Let me pray for you. Father, thank you. When my fear is crippling, you are true. Even in my wandering, you are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in the year death has lost its sting. Nothing compares.